Spirit. The Lord be with you. Welcome on this evening as we come together once again with great gratitude as a congregation here in this holy place to celebrate this season of ordinary time with all the green and growing things that are still around us. And we take this moment to pause and to reflect and to worship with one another. Let us give thanks to God. Let us begin our service with the confession.
God the Father, forgive us in Christ, that heals us by the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore put away all anger and bitterness, all slander and malice, and confess our sins to God our Redeemer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought and word and deed, and in what we have left undone. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, we beseech you mercifully to hear the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may both perceive and know what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to fulfill them, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
The reading is from the prophet Jeremiah. It was the Lord who made it known to me, and I knew. Then you showed me their evil deeds. But I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter. And I did not know it was against me that they devised schemes, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, so that his name will no longer be remembered. But you, O Lord of hosts, who judge righteously, who try the heart and the mind, let me see your retribution upon them, for to you I have committed my cause. For the wisdom that guides us.
Hallelujah.
Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. Jesus and his disciples passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And after 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying, and were afraid to ask. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all, and servant of all." And he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." This is the Gospel of the Lord. May I speak in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. It took me quite a long time to decide what picture was going to go on the cover of this week's service sheet. It's one of my favourite ones that Raphael did. I don't know whether you know the Apostolic Palace in Rome. I suspect you will know it much better than I do. But he created a series of rooms which are known as the stanza. And the one that's on the cover is from the Stanza del Segnatura and is known as the School of Athens. It's one of, I think, Raphael's finest works. It's on the opposite side of the room is a piece called Disputa, where various philosophers and theologians are disputing the nature of the Eucharist. And opposite, on the opposite wall, is the School of Athens. And I think it portrays something of an unfortunate dichotomy, in that we can, on the one hand, have theology, and on the other hand, have science. It suggests that there is a sizable gap between the two disciplines. I'm not always sure that that's helpful. Part of the question, it seems, is that science likes definite answers to particular questions. Those of you that have heard me speak before will know that one of my favourite books is that trilogy in four parts, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And if you're a fan of it, either in book form, on the radio, TV, or film, you may well remember that the answer to life, the universe, and everything is 42. It may be that 42 is indeed the answer to life, the universe, and everything. But as Douglas Adams pointed out in his book, that's merely the answer. It's not the question. And it seems sometimes that theology is there to ask those questions about the why and the how, rather than the what. It gives a space to ponder questions that science can't answer, and that science really doesn't want to answer, because there isn't a definite yes or no, right or wrong, this or that. Because part of the joy of theology is that we don't live in a black and white world. We have all of those shades of grey in between, which theology allows us to explore helpfully. But without coming down, or this is the only answer. And it seems to me that from time to time the church occasionally falls foul of this itself. It wants to try and pin things down. As James said in his sermon last week, if you remember, he began with a joke about the Baptist, the Roman Catholic and the Anglican, where the Baptist referred to the Bible, the Roman Catholic referred to the church, and the Anglican, well, the Anglican didn't have a proper answer. I think that that is entirely true, and I'm comfortable, at least I am comfortable, being in that middle, not wanting to have a definite answer, but being able to rejoice that there are more than one answers, that I have no chance of even knowing what the question is, let alone understanding the answer. Elections to General Synod are happening at the moment, and if you are an elector, as I know some of you are, thankfully not everybody because it would just be too tedious, you will have been bombarded with the election addresses of candidates. I find it very interesting reading them. Most of them try very, very, very hard not to tell us what they think on issues like sexuality or whether the church should be open to blessings. It's interesting to see how the different groups have been carefully avoiding even thinking about the question while pretending to give helpful steers. This next Quinquennium of the Church of England's General Synod will be an interesting one. Traditionally, the House of Bishops is the House of Bishops and it more or less does what it's told. The House of Laity tends to be much more conservative. The House of Clergy has in the past tended to be much more liberal. One can only guess what this series of elections are going to throw up this time. Because the church, it seems, is suffering, or has been suffering, from issues such as the nature of the parish, the support it gives to clergy, its history and reputation on safeguarding. All of these are questions that they will have to struggle with, without, I suspect, ever quite understanding what the question actually is. Two other readings today reflect back also from last week into this. Last week Jesus was asking the disciples, "Who do you think I am?" And they couldn't give a straight answer. This week the disciples, and this is where my sermon makes its theoretical point, is that they were missing the questions entirely. They were focused in on themselves, of who was the greatest, rather than what or who or how was Jesus. As so often the disciples do, and as so often we do, they completely miss the questions that they should be answering and the questions that they should be asking. And what Jesus is telling them, as the Jeremiah reading predicts, that he will die on the cross. The disciples themselves are too busy thinking about their own worldly affairs and their own status and their own problems. It's telling that at this time of General Synod elections, perhaps the church shouldn't be thinking about itself, but should instead be trying to think on wider issues. Of justice, of peace, of hope, and of generosity, and reminding us that we can only see one very small part of God's salvation, but we can be assured that it is much wider and broader and more generous than we can possibly imagine. Amen. Thank you.
Let us say what it is we believe in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray as we sit earlier. We pray as a church we may ask the right questions. To be a house of prayer, of welcome, of hospitality to all who enter its doors. We give thanks for the Pope, the Ecumenical Patriarch, and the Archbishop of Canterbury, and their statement this week on environmental issues and being good stewards of creation. Help us to play our parts individually and as a church. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the whole human family, for peace, for justice, and freedom for all people, for the ending of warfare, civil strife, corruption and exploitation. Grant to all who are in positions of authority and power, and to their advisors, integrity and moral courage to seek to do what is right. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who are sick. Be near to the brokenhearted. Save those whose spirits are crushed. We pray for those who struggle with mental health challenges. We pray for those who have a healing ministry. We pray for the work of all relief agencies, especially for the work of the Red Cross, helping Afghan refugees here in Kensington and Chelsea. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For those prayers in our hearts this evening, we pray. And we continue to pray for Rose Anderson, John Barbridge, Buddy Priestley, Alice Taylor, Mauricio, Jean Locke, and Aaron Cook. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the recently departed, for Pat Turner and Adrian May, and at the anniversary of Michael Fulham, Ada Ehrenberg, Doris Bishop, Barry Davis, Stuart Simpson, Selwyn Clark, David Eustace, Valerie Merchant, and John Kennedy. May they rest in peace
and rise in glory.
We pray our prayers with all those throughout the centuries, joining the saints and Mary, the Mother of God, as we greet her and say,
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death.
Peacemakers, for which they shall be called children of God. We meet in the name of Christ, the one who came to bring peace to our world. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Let us offer one another a sign of peace, albeit socially distanced. Duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God.
From sunrise to sunset, this day is holy. For Christ has risen from the tomb and scattered the darkness of death with light that will not fade. This day the risen Lord walks with your gathered people and falls for us your word and makes himself known in the breaking of the bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live in endless light, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so with choirs of angels and with all the heavenly host, we proclaim your glory and joy their unending song of praise. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."
Great is the mystery of faith.
And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice, our praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup. And we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of Our Lady, St. George, St. John the Baptist, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
Being made one by the power of the Spirit, as our Savior has taught us, so we pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Sing our final hymn.